yeah. Everywhere I see the black and blue uniforms, police and priests, men and their republic, septic eye, suffering the screaming sea. So hello everyone, and today I'm joined by my sidekick Tim from the Irish Megaphone. We'll be giving our opinions on the recent Euro and local elections that we just had last week. Just to note, we're both under the weather. I think it's the change in the temperature from spring to summer, maybe back again. It's getting to us, or it could be the after effects of the elections kicking in. I don't know. So how are you, Tim, today?
I'm grand. I'm kind of recovering. I've been ill as well since I did my last video in Lisbon, and could be the change of weather. It could be the election results. Who knows?
You know. Yeah. So you must have took it hard with Kieran Cuff getting elected.
I did. Yeah, I was very upset about that. I was upset about the Greens in general. You know. But look, I'll get over it. It's kind of okay. It has to be like an open declaration of war now on my channel. I've decided that.
It gives you a lot of material to play around with now.
It does.
I mean, they're comedy gold, really. I think the Green Party.
I know they're gas. Like it's. But I was really surprised. I know you were saying it beforehand that they could do very, very well. You know? And I didn't think people would be that stupid. You know, but you know, what do I know? I was wrong. You know, so yeah. Especially in the councils, I think they got about 42 seats.
I'm not sure about the final number, but
I think it was 42,
well.
And I was really taken aback by that. And but I just wonder, was it just people? You know, what's the word I'm looking for? Just deserting the traditional parties and then trying to find someplace else to go. And the Greens seemed like a kind of a good fit. Maybe people who aren't yet aware of the new options that are out there, you know, they just wanted somewhere to go. They didn't want to go to the traditional parties, you know. So maybe I'm thinking it's something to do with it.
Well, I think it's probably a younger electorate, maybe from the that came in first time voting, maybe mm-hmm. they would see the Greens as something. Mm-hmm. I don't necessarily think that they would have taken votes off Sinn Féin or Labour, mm-hmm. Because the working class clearly didn't go out to vote. But I think they would have got a lot of, you see a lot of Fine Gael heartland, some of it switched over to Greens. So, mm-hmm. you know, because a lot of them got elected in like Sandyford and Dunleary and, you know, all these Clontarf and all these nice places. But anyway, mm-hmm. so the title of today's thing is Democracy in the Banana Republic. It's going to be just a look back at the election, but also, what is this a true democracy? Is it really democracy, what we've seen in the elections in Ireland? So we're going to look through a few of the issues and we'll just give our opinions on it. Okay, so the first one, what did you think of the low turnout? I mean, do you think there were reasons less than half the people bother to vote?
I would say possibly apathy. You know, maybe some people are watching Manchester United playing or whatever, I don't know. But I think people have become generally quite apathetic and possibly a sense of helplessness or a sense of, you know, does my vote really matter? You know, and I think people, it's like, whereas people like yourself and myself, where I would obviously care about my vote in the sense that, because I suppose to a certain extent, somewhat politically aware, if you like. So I realized that, you know, that I have to vote. It's the only voice I have at the moment besides my YouTube channel, you know. So whereas I think the majority of people, I suppose, they're too busy with their iPads and their iPods and looking at X Factor and all that. And they don't really see how, I suppose, people feel a sense of that they are so small in this big machine that it's almost irrelevant and there's no point. And they feel that it's beyond them. Not everyone, of course. A lot of people just don't care, I imagine, you know, or they don't see why they should care. And I think a lot of that too is down to, I think there are those of us who see the dangers that are coming now down the line in the coming years. And most people are, in effect, you know, still asleep. They're at the wheel. They're just too busy with their lives. They have too many bills to pay. They're worried how they're going to meet their next mortgage bill. Yeah. And, you know, the normal everyday things of life, you know, they're overwhelmed by them. So they kind of, for them, it's kind of a pointless exercise. They don't yet see that there's an alternative out there. And I suppose, you know, we'll talk about it now in a moment when we talk about Iregsic or the Gemma O'Dohertys of this world haven't, if you like, haven't reached these people yet. These people don't know that these kind of individuals exist. So they feel hopeless in one sense. You know, that would be be, you know, one way of looking at it, maybe. What do you think?
Well, I mean, do you think like the people, like you see in Australia, it's mandatory to vote, and if you don't vote, you pay a fine, or do some community service. What would you think of a system like that?
Well, it would probably, you'd have a much higher voting turnout, obviously, you know, because people, no one wants to pay a fine. But I just kind of, I wonder about that. I can see. You can see how it would benefit the poll. You'd obviously get a lot more people voting, but then those particular people who are being compelled to vote, you know, are they voting correctly in the sense that are they just going in just to tick any old box? You know, who would they vote for? I don't know. It's a tough one, you know, but it's maybe it might be worth trying once or twice. I don't know, you know.
Well, I wouldn't agree with that at all. I mean, forcing people to vote.
I'd be somewhat skeptical about the value of it, in that you have people voting for God knows what, you know, just for the sake of to avoid a fine, you know.
So just for example, like in one place, like a lot of places in inner city Dublin now, it was less than 45%. In one place, in the Blanchardstown, the turnout was 30.3% for a 5-seater, and the quota was 831. But the 5th seat was taken by a Freddie Cooper, I think it was Fianna Fáil, and he got in by 502 votes. So if you, I think for some of the people who are thinking of getting elected in the future, that's the place to go, Blanchardstown. You know, all you need is 500 people to vote for you. Just go down to the few of the pubs.
Exactly, and, buy a few pints there, you know.
Herd them out.
Exactly, But it just, it shows, really, doesn't it, how it's, there's very little in it, in a lot of these seats, you know, there's very, very little in it. You know, if you think about it, if you're, for example, if you're someone who's going for election and you know that, you know, that the difference between you being elected and not being elected could literally be just 100 votes or 150 votes or 50 votes or whatever. You know, if you're a person who can strategize well and really plan things out well in advance, you could quite easily, you know, achieve that goal of getting those votes by, you know, just reaching out to people in a very kind of, in a clever way as well, especially. I don't see many of the newer politicians now using especially in Ireland, using technology very well. Like, if you even go back to Gemma O'Dohertey, she has her YouTube channel. I mean, how many politicians have a YouTube channel of their own?
I mean, people will say that they're lazy, they're working classes, like working class areas, run down areas, that don't vote because they're lazy, so and so is. But I don't know. I just think that I still have confidence that people would come out to vote if you get them something to vote for. If you get them a serious candidate, not the same old bullshit. And I know we had alternatives in this election, but you still need someone that's more in the public eye, you know.
Yeah, but look, that's what I said to you the last one when we chatted before the election. We talked about the importance of, you know, positioning your product in the mind of, in this case, voters, and people. And I, as I said before, you know, I've done it myself in the past. I've gone in, I didn't know who to vote for, so I just picked the familiar name or someone I was familiar with, in, you know, someone I'd heard of, you know. And and I think that is important, creating a kind of an awareness. You know, I was walking across the bridge there in Cork. It might have been the day before the election, and there's, if you know Cork, just by the City Hall, there's the City Hall, there's a bridge, and over to your left there's the old Sutton's Coal building, and there was an absolutely huge banner of Deirdre Clune hanging, rolled down halfway down the building. You know, it was almost I'd say it was the length, maybe I'm exaggerating saying it was the length of half the building, but it was quite large, you know. So you can see there someone who has a bit of money behind her, creating public awareness again. People who are independents or whatever, they just don't have the money to do those kind of things. In fact, I was saying to myself, how did she get up there? You know what I mean? On that building, you know, is it part of their family business or what? You know, because she comes from the Barry's Tea. That's her background, you know, that's her family. Yeah. So she's not short of a few bob. But awareness is extremely important in any business, you know, be it in the arts, in politics, in whatever your business is, whatever your product is. You have to get your product or who you are into people's minds. And if people like to feel safe, you know, people, in all, no matter what decision they make in life, people like to feel they're making a decision that, you know, people don't like stepping out into the dark. Even if it comes down to, you know, going to a shop and saying, will I buy a Sony stereo or will I buy a Samsung stereo or TV or whatever, you know. People like to have, people like familiarity, you know. They feel comfortable with that. And anything beyond that in their minds is taking a risk. And people are, by nature, risk averse.
Yeah. So perhaps then the next election would be, we will learn more about Gemma and Rexit, maybe.
Yeah, I think so. I think for me, this was really a warm-up. This was really a warm-up. And it's kind of, I suppose, like if you look at Herman Kelly now, I mean, I was really surprised. What was it? 3,000 votes? That was... That really took me aback. But the thing is, that would be good for him personally if he's going to go for election again in that constituency, and that he's going to say, okay, I'm really up against it now. So he might have to change his strategy a bit.
Yeah.
Gemma, now, I think on her YouTube channel, I've seen she has 18,000 subscribers. Yeah. What was her vote count again? Was it 17,000 or was that?
I think, let me just check. I think it was
around that. It was around that, actually, now that I think of it. I think Dolores Cahill was around the same as well.
Yeah, they didn't do too bad for a first-time candidate.
Exactly.
Without a party behind them, you know?
So, like, the thing is, I suppose, is that, like, their goal now, or should be for the next election, should be to just start to really expand. They've made their little beachhead now, you know? You know, when the Allies landed in Normandy, they create a little beachhead, and then from that beachhead, just pile all their troops in and just start spreading out, figuratively speaking, do you know what I mean? And it's the same thing with them. They've made their little beachhead. Now Gemma has created a little beachhead for herself, and she just needs to bring the troops in from behind and start to reach out and expand her reach with her YouTube channel. Now, again, I you know, for me, Gemma is, I don't know if you'd intended to start off talking about Gemma, but I feel I was chatting there, myself and my wife were chatting about the National Party, for example. Now, they didn't run this time around, but I see, when I look at the National Party, and we were comparing the National Party to Gemma, Gemma's ACI, which is essentially just one person at the moment, and we were talking about, and my wife said this to me, and I completely agreed with her, we kind of saw... We see the National Party are Justin and, like, Gemma did our little walkabout in Longford there a few days ago with James Reynolds. And we see, in my mind, we were talking about how we see the National Party as something, an entity that's very stable, that we can rely on, that won't put their foot in the mouth.
Maybe.
You know, whereas Gemma is kind of, there's that 5% in Gemma that is a bit of a loose cannon. And just gives people ammunition to attack her, you know. And I think that's really something she needs to watch. Go on.
I guess you could say that even with all that, she still managed to get 10,000, 12,000, you know. So
absolutely. She'll still have her debt with all that.
Yeah. I was just looking at, like, you're talking about, like, Herman Kelly didn't do great, but I'm looking at Luke Mingflanagan. I'm on his page here now. And in his first election, he got 548 votes. His second election, he got 779 votes. A local council election, then in the general election, 779 in the 2002 general election. And then you bring it right up to the Midlands Northwest, and he got in the final count, 121,824. So that's some jump. From him starting off 548 votes, 1.1%, to the European election 2019, and he got 14.3%. He got in second place, 121. So, you know, just keep plugging away. If that's the game you want to play, just keep plugging away, you know?
But, like, it's like with any, if you think about it, really, Rob, it's, you know, becoming a good politician or developing as a politician, it's like a skill. It's like any skill. The more you practice, the more experience you accumulate, and hopefully that with experience comes wisdom, and you can kind of strategize yourself a bit. You know, you become better, essentially.
Did you see the guy that got one vote?
I thought he got two. Didn't he get a second one? Did he get
maybe a second? That was a recount, wasn't it?
I don't know.
His parents voted for him. The next thing about the election, there's far too many seats. I mean, what you said previously in the last video, you know, give more power to councils because they can kind of subvert. Well, what were you saying? You were saying give them more. You were saying give them more power to the
council. Yeah, I think we were talking about the mayoral election, weren't we?
Yeah, but I think it transfers well over to the councils as well, because you're giving them. It seems that the councils have a lot of power these days. I don't know. Maybe they don't. I don't know. I mean, what do you... I want to know, like, why are there so many county councillors in the country? I mean, why the need for a small town of 20,000 to 25,000 to have 5 or 6 county councillors? Why does Naas, for example, why does a town like Naas need 7 councillors of a population of 26,000? Mm. I mean... Are the people in Naas getting the benefit of having so many councillors? I don't think so. It just seems like
excessive.
On top of all the TDs, the senators, and all the other
system is just set up so they can have a seat for everyone in the house. You know, yeah. You know, like the old Gay Byrne late show. You know, we've one for everyone in the house or in the audience.
Well, if they're setting up their own political class. Yeah. They have their own class now. They're a politician and. And we keep feeding into it and for me it's like a dole for the rich, you know. This is how you can keep these people going for life. Yeah. They can go round and round being councillor, TD, back again, senator, NGOs. You can move from one to the other for their whole life, really doing nothing. And that's their kind of dole, really. And we're feeding into it. And instead of increasing them, we should be reducing it. Mm. But no politician will ever do that, because that'd be like turkeys voting for Christmas. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. And it feels like they're purposely remaining aloof, so they can get away with fiddling the system. And they're hoping that people lose interest, which they do. So they're free to carry on with their widespread corruption, doing whatever they do in the councils, land rezoning, dodgy deals. We've seen that from some councillors asking for deposits from companies before they do anything.
Agenda 2030 and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, because they'll always rely on that 1,000 or so, or we've seen 500 or so zombies to vote them in again and again every 4 years. Mm-hmm. And you know, is that democracy?
Is it democracy? I'll be honest, I've never really given thought before now to the actual quantity of councillors in the country, you know.
It's too many.
Yeah, but there are a lot of councillors, all right, Rob, you know. And
but you see, there's a councillor in Meath. Did you see that? Meath County Councillor Sharon Keown, I guess. She put her name forward in 2 elections, Laytown and in Ashburn. Hmm. And she actually won both of them.
What?
So she's bringing it to court. She's challenging the court to allow her to become the first woman to take 2 seats in the same constituency.
I'm sorry, but that's just the most bizarre thing I've ever heard in my life.
But I'm not sure if this has been done before. I think maybe Michael Collins did this before.
Yeah.
I'm not sure, but it's a typical Irish thing anyway.
it is a bit Irish, all right, yeah. That's...
So 2 for the price of 1, or...
I don't know. I saw this... video, it might have been, I don't know, was it an RTE or where it was, and people were being questioned about how they voted. This was afterwards. Mm-hmm. And I remember there's quite a few people, it was the same narrative. It was like, you know, sure, we voted for Fianna Gael all our life. My parents voted for Fianna Gael or Fianna Fáil, and their grandparents voted. And sure, wasn't Michael Collins a great man? This is like 100 years ago.
Yeah.
And it was horrific.
Da. How can your man run again? I thought he was a convicted criminal or something.
He fixed the road.
But sure, he robbed money.
What are you talking about? My father voted for his father and you'll vote for his son. He fixed the road.
My point there is there's too many politicians. I think we could snip one off every council seat, you know, or maybe 2 for big ones, larger councils. I mean, the argument is, I suppose the argument is the more county councillors, the more transparency and the more the vote is shared out amongst people. But the reality is different. It's not like that at all. You're just getting more Fianna Fáilers and more Fianna Gaelers in the trough. Mm-hmm. That's the reality. Exactly, yeah. That's never going to be changed. It need a radical overhaul, but no one would be brave enough to do that. Mm-hmm. So that leads me on to the next one then. going on from that is the saturation of the traditional parties. It's virtually impossible for independents or small parties to get a look in with a crowded field of well-established parties with a corrupt and biased media behind them, with a lot of money, and some of it public money, and an army of zombies and cult members built up over the years. So look at Herman with Ben Scanlon, the two of them on their own probably walking around Dublin handing out leaflets, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Against an army of Fianna Fáilers, you know.
Yeah, I mean, Herman had been on TV quite a bit, you know. I know he'd been a guest on Matt Cooper's show and Ivan Yates, I can't remember what that show was called, on Virgin Media. So it kind of surprised me that his vote count was really, really low, because of all the independent candidates, he was the one I would have expected to do pretty okay, you know, quantity wise, but he was well behind Gemma O'Doherty and Dolores Cahill, you know. Now I know
I wonder was there a bit of a rig in that, I wonder.
Who knows?
Because it didn't seem too small. I don't understand it.
Yeah. I don't know. It was a bit of a crowded field as well for independents. Mm. I know I tweeted you as well. I saw one of Gemma's recent videos, and I think it looks to me now that she's quite cross or annoyed with Ben Gilroy for some reason. You know, something's got on between them there, and she referred to him as a bit of a messer. That's the conclusion she has come to now, you know. I think she's of the view that he was kind of parachuted. I think what she was saying is that he was, the way I understood it, the way she was saying it, is that someone talked him into parachuting him into the Dublin constituency instead of his own constituency.
Okay.
I remember hearing some story, I don't know, was it directly from his camp at some stage, that, you know, we couldn't get the papers in times, so we just stuck him into Dublin instead, you know. But that sounded like a bit kind of bullshit to me personally.
I don't know. I mean, she did get a good lot of transfers for him though, I guess, when he was knocked out. But so the point with this is there's a saturation of parties. Like, generally, Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael, generally, in every council, they'll have two, minimum two, sometimes three, and Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael in each council, which kind of squeezes out the opposition. And not only do they have that, but you see on election night, you'll see from the transfers that a lot of transfers go from Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil, and vice versa. So instead of, you know, the two main parties who are meant to be in opposition, in reality, their transfers go towards each other and back and forward.
Yeah.
And also, to a lesser extent, Labour to Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael. So as night follows day. And then the Greens. Now you have the Greens. And the Greens, you've seen with the transfers, a lot of Greens went to Fine Gael. Even Greens and Labour, they're meant to be different parties, but they're all helping each other. And, you know, so where's the alternative there?
Yeah, and I noticed that as well. I noticed there was it among some of the independents, are people, what I noticed, I don't, were we chatting about this on, were we, I'm not too sure, were we messaging each other about this, but I noticed with some independents, they would get a certain quantity of vote, then they would be eliminated, and all their votes, their transfers, would seem to migrate over to people who are ideologically the complete opposite.
I just couldn't
get my head around it. I think it kind of exposes the ignorance of voters. You know, they don't really know what they're voting for, you know, they don't.
Well, they had a case, and the guy who topped the poll in Offaly for Renew, who are an anti-abortion pro-life party, they found that most of his, the number one of his transfers transferred to his running mate in Renew, but the second most of his transfers transferred to somebody who set up the repeal the eight.
Yeah, that was, yeah, actually, that was the one. I think we were talking about that, yeah. That was the one.
So that doesn't make sense. How could you vote for a pro-life party and then give number two or number three to someone who set up repeal the eight in Tullamore or Offaly or whatever? I mean, it doesn't make sense. And you've seen it on election night. You were looking at the I was looking at transfers. I was looking at it all night and all day. That's why I'm whacked out still. But some of the transfers were strange.
But you're right. Like, I mean, it just exposes, like I said, it just exposes that people don't really have, they haven't done their research. They're kind of voting aimlessly.
Yeah. Well, you would. That's Well, the other way to account is that there's some dodgy dealing in it. Maybe someone just added in a few twos and threes with a pencil, but you never know. Yeah. I wouldn't put anything past the Irish authorities, to be honest.
Yeah.
So my point is to say there's any real difference between the parties is bullshit, and the fact you can see that on election night with all the transfers from all the main parties, they all help each other, drag each other over the line. So what that says to me is today I will follow the Fianna Fáil criminal network. Maybe tomorrow I'm a working man in Labour. Maybe the next election I'm going to save the world with the Green Party. And maybe the election after that I'll be back with Fine Gael.
Yeah.
Because there's no difference. There's no difference between them. But despite all that saturation, in the local elections, despite all the hoo-ha, Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil barely improved. Fianna Fáil were up 2.6% in the local elections, and Fine Gael got a little less than the last election. So they know that they can't go back to the country for a general election. Because they did okay, but they didn't do as they're not pulling away as they used to do in the years ago. You know, they're not getting the 40% that they used to when I was growing up.
Mm-hmm.
It's 25% maximum now, or 20%.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but was in those days, Rob, were most people would be like, I'm assuming you would have had a much higher voter turnout. Would that be correct in those days?
That's a good question. Local elections, I can do. Check local elections, Ireland.
I suppose what I'm saying, again, it's coming back to what I said earlier, that is it a case of that these days voters are more apathetic?
I don't know. I think that the days of huge election turnout in Ireland were in the 70s, 60s and 70s.
Like in those days, it was a much more important thing. It was much more important for one to get out and vote than possibly it is today. Today, it's a kind of a take it or leave it. I won't vote this year. Maybe I'll vote next year, but I won't bother,
So let's talk about the quality of the politician. A lot of the candidates, you know, they're solicitors, they're accountants, businessmen, active. Then you have the other side, they're activists and the like, they're NGOs.
School teachers.
There's no ordinary people. No.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, they're all as dumb as a rock anyway, as far as I'm concerned, you know. I don't see. There's very, very few smart politicians now. I mean, in this election, that's why I primarily voted for Dolores O'Riordan, because I thought she was a very smart cookie, you know. Yeah. Very intelligent, very articulate.
Yeah.
And that's why she got my number one vote.
Well, talking about Dolores Cahill.
Dolores Cahill. What did I say? Dolores O'Riordan.
Well, Dolores Cahill, yes. I made a point in the notes that I find there's a lot of, I don't know how I should say this, dolly birds is probably a bit too strong, but you know, this new type of woman in politics. I mean, they're the kind of women that do their shitty college degree, environmentalism or women's study or cultural studies or some bollocks, and they take a year out or two, maybe go to Africa, work for some charity, or maybe NGO in the European Union or the United Nations. Or if they're really given a short straw, they might do something on mental health for a while in the local communities. But they're always told, be nice, always be polite, smile as much as you can. They do it for career progression and with an eye further down the line of politics, you know, so they can point to their activism and work they've done in the past. And I think you could say they're like Stepford wives. These are like Stepford politicians, you know, always nodding their head in photo ops and standing behind the leader and looking pretty. Now, you could say I'm sexist or whatever, but no, because I look at someone like Dolores Cahill, and she's a real, I was going to say real fucking woman. I don't want to sound bad, but like, you know, that's what a real feminist is. You know,
well, she's somebody who has achievements under her belt, genuine achievements in business and, you know, academically speaking as well. And very, very, it's obvious from the get-go, she's incredibly smart.
A strong, opinionated woman.
Yeah.
Like a shallow man would be afraid of her. Yeah. She's not going to go in and nod the head and just, you know, say nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So as you understand what I'm saying,
I know exactly what you're saying.
When you put someone up like the, you see the swing lady, what's her name?
She's Maria Bailey. Did you hear that interview on the radio?
It was just
unreal. I just couldn't believe what I was listening to.
But they're interchangeable. She looks exactly like them all, and they're all the same. You know, someone like Dolores Cattell, I mean, as you said, serious credentials, strong, opinionated woman. Mm-hmm. Men respect women like that because I think so. I have a setting for you. Okay, I'll give you the setting. This is the way I see politics, the reality. You've a dark room. There's a meeting on in Strasbourg. There's smoke billowing all over the room. You've all white men in suits sitting around a table deciding how much more pain Ireland should get next year. How can we ratchet up the pain on these morons? Suddenly there's a knock on the door and it's Maria Walsh. Hi. Hello, everybody. I'm new here. I'm here to save the world. You know, they look at her and politely tell her, no, your office is down. Your meeting is two doors down with the door marked Clown World.
Yeah.
You know, that's how it works. Yeah. That's the reality. And, you know, there's a great example of this on the internet. I'll try and fish it out if I can. Same thing, old white men and Jewish men as well. There's in the House of Lords, they're around the table. Very dark. I don't know. These vampires, they never get out. They don't like the brightness. And they're talking about immigration to Europe and how they can help the immigrants into Europe. And these are all old white men and Jewish men, lords. And Peter Sutherland is chairing it. And again, you get the impression from looking at these men that they're the real rulers, you know. So all this democracy and politics, it's a sham because, you know, by looking at this, I'll try and get that video, but it happens. You know that that's the real democracy.
Mm-hmm. I mean, if one looks at the key arguments and issues relating to migration and the need for migration, the demographic is the most fundamental. And the challenges, demographic challenges, in a number of European member states, however difficult it may be to explain this to the citizens of those states, is absolutely unquestionable in terms of crucial dynamic for economic growth. And declining population, aging population, is destructive of prosperity, forgetting about the moral aspect of migration entirely, and that's particularly relevant to a number of the countries of Central Germany itself is a major issue, but also some of the southern states. So the demographics are a key element in this debate and a key argument for, and I hesitate to use the word because people have attacked it, for the development of multicultural states.
So this thing of voting in the likes of Maria Walsh or Mairead McGuinness, you know, all she can do is say yes, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. They're not really doing, that's a sham.
Yeah, no,
someone like Dolores Cattell, even Gemma Doherty, even they wouldn't be able to control Gemma.
No, absolutely not. Absolutely mm-hmm. not. I think a lot of people are really afraid of Gemma, you know, despite her tendency to be a bit of a loose cannon at times. They would be afraid of her. Absolutely, you're right. So I don't think you're far off the mark, really, you know?
Yeah. So talking about the caliber of the politician, the men are not much better now, to be honest.
No.
Did you see the three county councillors that were exposed in the prime time for asking for bribes?
I saw the one guy, there's a video of one chap, I don't know what his name is now, where he was, give me 10 grand and I'll get you your windmill.
Exactly.
But he was kind of claiming then that, wasn't he claiming that, oh sure, I knew they had a secret camera, I knew they were coup de bois, so I was just playing their game, you know, taking the piss out of them, essentially.
Very believable. But the three of them got elected.
Yeah.
So what kind of sick society is Ireland? That we, pure corruption like that, you know?
Yeah. It's Ireland.
Yeah, anyway, that's it. So that's the caliber of politicians. So we're going through the, this is, my point with this is it's a fake democracy. So we started with just the electorate, half the people don't vote. We followed it up with, there's too many councillors. The parties are swamping the elections you can't breed with all the Fianna Fáilers and Fianna Gaelers trying to get elected. Mm-hmm. And then the quality of politician is just the lowest of the low. So again, you keep saying, you know, people keep saying this is a, it's a democracy. Great. It's, I don't know.
Yeah. It's a special Irish form of democracy, isn't it?
I don't know. Yeah, it is actually. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe it's the same in other countries. I don't know.
Yeah. It's like, do you remember when we had our pre-election discussion, we were talking about how people vote in the UK. You know, I was listening this morning there, and when I got up, there was an interview with Julia Hartley Brewer and Jacob Rees-Mogg. They were talking about how the current mayor of London, he was slagging off Donald Trump, you know, and essentially Donald Trump responded that, you know, that essentially the London mayor said he can't, he's just a nobody really, he's just ruining the city, you know. But Jacob Rees-Mogg, they were just talking in general, he was just saying that, you know, Sadiq Khan's comments about the American president were essentially disgraceful. But
yeah,
the thing is, anytime I listen to someone like him, he's just so smart, he's so erudite, he's so articulate, yeah, you know. And yeah, and I remember when we discussed the pre-election discussion, we talked about, I was saying that, you know, the electorate in the UK, in my opinion, are far more contemplative, if you like, before they vote for someone. They tend to be a bit more selective and particular about who they vote for. Whereas yeah, in Ireland, it's a kind of, people are a bit more feckless with who they choose yeah to vote for. Now, having said that, the selection of people for whom we can vote for in Ireland is somewhat lowbrow compared to the UK. Yeah. You know, you can see that when you look at speeches in the Houses of Parliament and then you compare it to the Dáil.
Yeah.
You know, it's you can
well,
see.
Well, I'm sure if you went online and you typed in 10 great speeches from the Houses of Parliament or the House of Lords, you would get some good speeches. But I'm sure if you typed in one good speech from the Dáil.
yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. Is there any memorable ones from the Dáil? Can you remember? I can remember Gogarty saying "fuck you." Remember that one?
No, I don't.
Remember, he used to be in the Green Party.
No, I don't remember that at all.
I respected your sincerity. I'd ask you respect mine. Well, all due respect in the most unparliamentary language, fuck you, Deputy Stagg.
Sorry,
fuck you.
Hey,
I apologise now for my use of unparliamentary language.
Deputy Fogarty, that is most unparliamentary language.
It is most unparliamentary language.
Would you please
withdraw, I now withdraw it and apologise for it. But I'm outraged that someone dares question my sincerity on this issue. I don't like what has to be done, but I'm going to take the responsibility and get it on the chin and get the unpopularity and lose my seat, because it's the only thing we can do to get this country out of the state we're in. I firmly believe
Deputy
that.
Deputy Shortall, Deputy Costello.
I firmly believe that. And you respect my view. I didn't cause the economic mess. I didn't
Shortall,
take money from
please
developers or leave the. Or I didn't.
Deputy Shortall.
That's the point.
Deputy Shortall.
The point is.
Deputy
the
Shortall.
Point is. We are screwed.
Deputy
the point is, we are screwed as a country
Costello,
because of the wrongdoing of others.
Kind of, we just don't have that. But then again, you know, you look at these people like Jacob Rees-Mogg. They've all been educated at Eton and so on. You know, so they've all got the classical education. You know, where people are learn how to. How, you know, the people, they study philosophy and learn how to think
yeah
critically and all that, whereas we just don't get that in Ireland, you know?
Some of our politicians can't read or write.
Yeah.
So the next one, I have dodgy dealing. Now, I don't know what to think about this, because already we've seen that there were some postal voting shenanigans, and some people were saying that online that they got more than one ballot card. And I seen News Talk showed before that in their report that they did a few years ago, that there's about 500,000 overstated on the electoral register.
Mm-hmm.
And that was done a few years ago. So God only knows what it's like now. I'll put the link in my video description.
Well, there was some years ago there, I was getting two polling cards. I do remember that one
yeah
here where I live now, and a polling card used to come to my, a second polling card used to come to my parents' house.
Yeah, yeah, it's common.
And
common.
One was for a different voting centre.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
so I could easily have voted twice had I wanted. No, I didn't do that. I'm
yeah
too honest for that. Like, but I can see how easily I think that needs to be completely reformed, you know.
Well, there even in this election now, a Fine Gael councillor made a complaint, or I think he was councillor in the last election, but he made a complaint to Garda amid a surge of number of postal votes in Sligo. And he was saying that postal cards with Polish people's names on them and should haven't been in Ireland in 10 years or something, you know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. People, and then other people were working abroad, and you know.
Yeah, when I lived in Germany, you probably, I'm assuming it's quite similar in Switzerland, that, you know, if I moved to a certain town, let's say, I have to go to the local office, town hall, and I have to register that I'm now living there.
Yeah, same.
And
same here,
when I left, I have to deregister.
Yeah, I have to deregister.
It's required by law, so you can see straight away how they know who's where.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
So that scenario would probably never arise where people are getting double polling cards, you know?
Yeah. Well, I think it's a good system, really, because at least the council here knows everybody in the community, you know, and for better or for worse, they have their eyes on you, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So just the next one then, nepotism, you know, brothers and sisters, uncles and aunts, husbands and wives, daddy, mammy, cousins. It's un-fucking believable.
Wasn't there a couple, they were a married couple, they were both elected?
Yeah, that's the Chinese lady and her husband.
Uh-huh.
Have you seen that? It's hilarious. Her husband is really soy to the eyeball.
No, I haven't seen him.
My Jesus, I can see how that relationship works.
Yeah, I just saw the photographs on Twitter.
They're not. It's not a power couple anyway.
Yeah.
I can see who wears the trousers in that relationship. You know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Did you see the Healy Rays were on?
Seven of them. Yeah. I think seven or eight. Is it? I don't know. Yeah.
They're so kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? They're so eccentric that I almost don't mind.
Well, they're pro-life. They're pro-life anyway, so that's one positive again with them, you know.
And they're kind of, they would oppose the greenism as well, which would be another plus in their favour, you know. So in that sense, I don't really mind them too much, you know.
So are we all moving to Kerry then?
We might have to, you know, to avoid all those carbon taxes.
Yeah, Jesus. Yeah. I mean, I had a list prepared, but honestly, it was getting so out of hand. It would have taken me, if I went through the list of all the relatives, it would have taken me an hour to go through it.
I'd believe it here.
I don't know. It's unbelievable. I mean, and you know it's bullshit because some of the members of the same family are in different parties. It's just pure opportunism. I've seen, like, there's even brothers that are on different parties. You know, I think of the Andrews brothers, and I think there's one green fellow, one brothers, one is green and one is Fine Gael, and you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's just ridiculous.
But really, I mean, if you think about it, though, Rob, is there really that much difference between the parties now at this stage? Okay, you might have...
That's the point.
And, you might have, like you're saying there, you have one guy, one brother who's a Green. I mean, okay, he's probably a bit slightly more extreme in the environment than the guy in Fine Gael, but essentially their policies are all the same. They're all socialists.
Yeah, it's interchangeable. You know, as I said, they'll change after a while. I mean, look at Lou McDonald. So she used to be a Fianna Fáiler, like, so, you know. Do you want to talk about the new candidates briefly?
Well, there was the African lady I saw. Was it in... Was it Navan? Yeah, they were having a little celebration.
To lift her up, but I'd say she was fairly heavy to drop in here.
I think she was kind of... I think she's a Christian, actually, you know, so...
Yeah.
I think that she was kind of... you know, there was a few of her African friends standing around, you know, they were thanking God for her election and all that, you know. So I found that kind of interesting, you know.
Yeah, she's in the Fine Gael party and she's thanking God for bringing it.
Yeah, the other thing that, as a Christian myself, the one thing that I had a problem with that was that, you just hit the nail on the head. Someone who's a Christian, who's almost certainly pro-life, why she would be part of a party that is not pro-life, you know.
Yeah.
But then again, you know, I don't know what her thinking is. Maybe it's her unfamiliarity with the country and to some extent, but maybe she just figured, look, this is my way to get elected, just being part of such an entity, you know. So I suppose in her case, you could say it worked for her, you know. But I would be curious if I was having a chat with her, why are you as a Christian with an entity that has brought in a baby killing into this country.
Yeah, exactly. And it's kind of like, you know, it doesn't make sense. I mean, it's just, again, pure opportunism. You see, like, I mean, with the Hazel Chu one, like running for the Green Party in Pembroke, she's born in Ireland, parents from Hong Kong. I don't mind the Greens to be honest, it's because I see it as a protest vote more or less. But she was bleating on about racism in the press, like, you know, I mean, that was a little bit too much, because, you know, this bullshit. There's no racism in Ireland, you know. You know, I just find this insulting, because, you know, the only people doing any racial attacks are the black gangs roaming around Dublin, you know, beating up white kids. And so you can tell by the caliber of this person, by that shite that they're talking about. And before anybody has a hissy fit, you know, saying I'm a racist, my wife is not Irish, you know, so they can suck on that.
Neither is mine, so.
She says there's been a lot of online trolling. There are a couple of doors. People said that I'm Irish. Yeah, well, deal with it. That's just people saying shit, you know. You know.
But I find a lot of politicians tend to say those type of things, you know. How true are these statements in reality? Remember that Cork, that academic in UCC, the Muslim academic, he's always on the radio, and he was going on one day about, you know, the abuse he suffered in Ireland. Apparently some drunk guy shouted at him one night, like, and I'm like, oh, please, like.
Yeah, I mean, if Fianna Gael or Fianna Fáil came to my house, I can tell you, they'd get an awful lot of abuse. You know, but like, that goes with the territory, you know. If you're a politician, you should expect all sorts of things thrown at you. You know, that's just the verbals. It's verbals, you know. Anyway, so the point with this is, I don't mind, you know, the paid taxes. My point is, the paid taxes that are entitled to go for any party they want to. But I just am a bit cynical, because, you know, I've never voted for Fianna Fáil. I've never voted for Fine Gael. I'm impressed with all the parties, like many ordinary working class people are. And, you know, it's just funny that a lot of these immigrants coming in are suddenly Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil are Labour or all these shit parties, you know. So imagine, like, some of my background, that I've always seen Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael for the corrupt bastards that they are. They've always destroyed the country. And then they're importing in the voters, and they're importing in the candidates. So just when I was hoping that the zombies that vote for these cunts would die out, now they're importing them. So, you know,
That's going on. Yeah, exactly. But that's going on everywhere, Rob, really, where all these leftist parties, to me now they're all leftist parties, they're actually importing their voters.
Yeah,
so if you're importing a whole batch of voters, then you have to actually provide a candidate for these particular voters, you know, just to make absolutely sure they do vote for you, you know. So I think that's what's going on here to an extent.
Yeah, it is. It's obvious. I mean, people can call it conspiracy theory, but show me different. Just please show me different, you know.
Yeah,
I don't see it. Okay, Tim, I know you don't want to go there, but we kind of have to just touch on the green wave a little.
The green wave. Well, look, to be honest, Rob, to me, this was clearly a pre-prepared talking point.
Okay. Yeah,
regardless of how the Greens... Look, it was obvious that some of the more traditional parties were going to lose a few seats, and the Greens were almost certainly going to gain some. And you predicted that yourself. So I think this whole idea of a green wave was totally pre-prepared. It was a total PR campaign. I think this whole thing of a green wave is totally fictitious. It's made up. It's bullshit, basically. You know, I think, like you said, I think a lot of it was just a protest vote. Obviously, I was disappointed that Kieran Cuff got. I was just surprised, you know, and I was delighted that lady Saoirse McHugh, is it, this new starlet of the Green Party? I'm delighted she didn't get in.
Well, I had her 50-1. I was a little bit disappointed.
You said that, all right?
I wanted to get some money from the election.
Actually, I think Eamon Ryan himself had a few quid on her, you know. So he actually published a photograph of his betting docket, you know. So.
But I was just like, my opinion, like, we've seen this game before. We've seen the Greens come before. Like, they went in with Fianna Fáil, didn't they? Went in with Labour, the toxic party, Fianna Fáil. So it's not like this is a new thing. It's not like this is the first time we've ever voted for the Greens, you know? And we've seen what happened last time. We had to get a big bailout from the World Bank. So this is going to be fun if they go into government with Fianna Fáil or Fine Gael in the next Mm-hmm. Because this, someone said, who was it? Someone from the Labour Party. Let me check it here. He's a clown. Who is he?
Alex White?
No, I know there's a lot of clowns in the Labour Party, but Humphreys, I think his name is. I can't remember. But he said that, what's his name? Ryan, isn't it? Eamon Ryan is going to have the balance of power in the next election.
That's very worrying, isn't it?
But he probably is. He probably
is. Very, very worrying. I mean, this guy's a nutcase.
And he's talking about, what was he talking about? He was talking about we need to ensure that every home does not burn fossil fuels and has a heat pump and a solar panels. Every house in the country has a heat pump and solar panels.
This is just so, who's going to pay for that? Like,
I think he was talking about like 5 billion or 6
These
billion.
These people are lunatics. They're absolutely lunatics. I was responding to Dan Boyle said some stupid statement about wind power on last night on Twitter, and I responded to him, right? Now, if you think about going forward, the increasing energy demand every year is going to be like 2%. I'm not just talking about Ireland only now, Rob, okay? Mm-hmm. But as you know, as we go forward, the increasing demand for energy will be 2%, right? Now, just to cater for that 2%, okay, not the existing energy demands, but just that 2% over 50 years, you would have to cover Russia, every square mile of Russia, in windmills.
Oh, yeah.
This is how not...
And he probably said, that's a great idea, let's work on it.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
I mean, solar panels. He's talking about solar panels in Ireland where it fucking rains every second day.
It's a joke. And when, you know, you hear this thing about, this bullshit about, 14% of our energy is renewables. What they're not telling you is that most of that 14% is from wood chip burners. They do it in such a way that you give the impression when they say renewables, they mean wind and solar. No, that's bullshit. Up at least 75 to 80% of that is from burning wood chips.
Okay, that's interesting. Yeah.
And most people don't realise that.
That's probably to bridge the gap because there's so little energy coming from the solar and the wind. Green Party candidate Alan O'Connor, who took the final seat in Cove, the student teacher, for fuck's sake, said his priority will be the environment. That's his priority. Mm-hmm. Vote for me is a vote for the environment. I'm looking to the environment for my votes. I mean, it's silly, isn't it? he's trying to get the appeal to the tree vote, you know?
Yeah. I assume he's doing his H-dip or something, is he? Is that what he means by student teacher?
I don't know.
Probably, yeah.
Maybe he's a long-term student teacher, like Micheál Martin. Isn't he still technically a teacher?
Enda Kenny, isn't
I don't know. I thought Micheál was a teacher. Well, Enda Kenny was one too, wasn't he?
Well, he was a primary teacher, wasn't he?
But he still was drawing it down.
Well, I think he was holding his job there, you know?
Yeah.
After a few years ago.
Let me see. I'm sure if Micheál was... Barton's time as a teacher was short-lived. He left after 1 year.
But sure, look, in fairness, historically, most of the Dáil has consisted of solicitors and teachers.
Yeah. So basically, let's get ready for host regulations, local and national level, host new taxes, limitations on energy usage, no turf now, there won't be any turf now for us, electric cars, anything else you can see?
Well, obviously the carbon taxes are what's coming.
Yeah, carbon taxes.
But after that, what most people I know, I don't know if I've brought this up with you before. In fact, I brought it up in my last video on the climate cult, on the one about language. The carbon taxes are coming next. After that will be the allocation of a system. And this ties into the cashless system where cash will be removed, where people's money, if you like, will be based on their energy usage or carbon credits. So you'll be allocated a certain amount of energy credits per year, and you won't be able to carry them over into the next year, so you won't be able to save any money. It's kind of the ultimate road towards the new feudalism or serfdom, where the whole economy and currency will revolve around energy usage and your energy credits, you know. You can hear some lunatics already on the media talking about, you know, if you take more than one flight a year, for example, then that next second flight should be taxed, and then the third flight you take, they'll be taxed even more, you know. So it's all about getting people out of their cars. It's a war on the car. That's why you have so many cycle lanes and all this. My wife was up in Galway there recently. She was talking about how Galway has just got manic traffic up there. I've noticed that myself, even in Cork, the traffic has just become, I never remember the traffic being so bad. And it's, of course, it's all these fecking cycle lanes, you know, car movement is being restricted. And it's just becoming a nightmare to get around, you know, but it's all like, it's a form of psychological warfare where people's, if you like, desire or enjoyment of the car is being worn down. They're being programmed to hate the car, to hate traffic, to get them out into public transport, to get them, if you like, corralling them down this narrow corridor of environmental transport, the bicycle and all that, you know. And it's all part of this Agenda 21, Agenda 20, 30.
It's going to be divide and conquer. Well, you'll have rich people being driven around everywhere, while poor people are being on fucking push bikes. And you'll have, again, with the energy, you'll probably be able to buy energy credit to offset your, like the way they do in for national countries are allowed to do that, aren't they? They're able to buy. So you'll probably have that for your own house. A rich person can buy
energy
credits.
It's a big scam. Exactly. It's a big scam. And you've people like Kieran Cuff going on about the need, and Eamon Ryan, the need to bring in these carbon taxes. Like, these people are millionaires. It will never, ever, ever affect them.
Yeah, and also, I was going to say, with they're all vegan and everything. They want everybody to be eating fucking rice and, I don't know, bread and butter.
It is a cult.
And well, they'll be at the top restaurants eating the finest venison and veal and meats that you can ever get.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know,
it's the new feudalism. That's actually what it is. It's a new feudal system.
It is, yeah. So, Green Party Senator Grace O'Sullivan, okay, who's now an MEP, I think they're still counting that thing. She said people in Ireland are sick of being a laggard and want to see change. Adding that the government have been out of touch in these areas. Michael Pidgeon, who campaigned hard on climate change, I'm delighted to get 23% of the vote in a local election. I know a lot of people were indicating to me that they want to take action on climate change. I believe the public is sending a strong message, blah, blah, blah. So they're all saying this is what the public wants. But you have to remember, the Green vote in working class and lower middle class areas in the Dublin city was barely significant. So where are they going? Yes, they're going to the likes of Dunleary, Clontarf, Malahide, all these places, and they're the people that want to see change on the rest of us, you know.
Yeah.
Before we get too upset about it, in the end, the local results gains for the Green Party from the last election was a whopping 2.8%. out of an election where 50% didn't even vote, and even vote less for Green Party. So would you say it's the majority of what people want in the doorsteps of Ireland? I would not say so.
No, it's just a talking point. It's propaganda. It's a talking point. It's like this whole idea they were talking about, you know, oh, now we have a green wave. You know, it's all bullshit. It's made up. These are pre-prepared statements before the votes were even counted. It's a way of propagandizing people into believing that the majority of people actually want it. You know, I guarantee if you go down the street there and just knock in 10 or 20 doors, the people say, no, of course we don't want that. When you actually tell them what's coming, do you want that? No, we don't want that, you know. I don't believe most people want cycle lanes all over their city.
No.
You know, when I'm driving down the road, I don't see any bikes on these.
Exactly.
You're stuck in traffic and the cycle lanes are empty.
Well, once they start hitting people's pockets, that's the end of the Green Party, you know.
Is it really?
I think so.
You know, a lot of the people who voted for this now, with the new Green vote, if you like, these are all what I call graduates of the Green Schools movement, you know.
Yeah, but look at the war charge protest, you know. I mean, I think if they're insisting on putting solar panels in houses, sure, that's going to start a revolution, that would.
But I know there was talk, I know Gemma's mentioned it, and I have a newspaper article there somewhere. I never got around to it. it's about how all houses should be retrofitted, their boiler system, you know, should be retrofitted, and grants all subsidized again, of course. You see, you have people in the background lobbying from all this, maybe solar panel manufacturers, they're lobbying the government to, in effect, a lot of these people, these lobbyists are actually, they're like government sock puppets. So the government sets up these NGOs, these green NGOs to lobby themselves, you know. Yeah. So
that's good point,
what they do, they lobby them. It's like the government lobbying itself. They set up an organization. The purpose of the organization is to lobby the government for certain regulations to be brought in.
Yeah, and, always on the take, always on the
you know,
take.
And so that's how it works. It's like me, it's like you hiring me to lobby you to do something that you already want to do.
Yeah, so they have it set up already. They know what they're going to do. So just quickly, we'll just run through the. I wanted to talk about Sinn Féin and the Mad Left. I did say in my video that I did think that Sinn Féin were going to get a kick in, and I was right. And I did say with the left as well, because I felt that they've gone through the whole abortion thing and the LGBTQ whatever thing. They've done what they've meant to do. So now that the new politics is the Greens to bring in the carbon taxes and all this. So bye bye Mad Left. You're not needed anymore, you know. So as far as I can see, Sinn Féin, well, they've abandoned the working class. And they're, you know, you have to remember that Sinn Féin had 18 or 19 councillors in the Dublin City Council. You know, in a time they held the balance of power in Dublin, really, in a time of, you know, a housing crisis and people dying on the streets of Dublin, being homeless. So it's kind of funny. They're scratching their heads saying, how could the working class abandon us? You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think people like in the Dublin area, I think people like Gemma Doherty took quite a few votes from Sinn Féin, you know?
Yeah. Well, I think the new party into.
Yeah.
Definitely hit them.
That's right. That's right. You're right there. Yeah, absolutely.
No, I mean, when you see the difference of getting elected is a few hundred votes or even less in some places in small county councils, 100 even maybe, definitely hit them. So I think Sinn Féin now it's going to be very difficult. I think they're in a political cul-de-sac. You know, they tried to appeal to the upper middle class and they were used by the upper middle class. To, you know, bring them out of old style left wing politics, you know, real working class politics. And now they're kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place. They don't know what to do. They don't know who, you know, they're fucked really.
Yeah.
And that's good. I'm happy enough for them. Yeah. You know, fuck them.
Yeah.
They can go back to their retreat, and now they're stuck with a party full of posh idealistic dickheads and then the other side crazy lunatics, so it's not a good mix.
Yeah, not quite the way I put it, but I completely agree with you. Yeah, you fit the nail on the head there.
I mean, they do have all the psychopaths up north that'll still vote for them, but you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And I just want to make a point, and Bertie Hearn, the moron, tells RT he believes Sinn Féin's demise in the local elections has a lot to do with the party not being able to come to an agreement with the DUP for government in Northern Ireland. Isn't that bullshit? Because people in inner city Dublin really give a shit about what they're doing in Northern Ireland.
Yeah, they do.
Fucking clown, that fella.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's Sinn Féin. Labour are more or less the same, but the Labour are thinking of going in. They're thinking of going in with the Social Democrats and even the Greens for the future. So
look, these people, they're hacks, right? They just see which way the wind is blowing and then they jump onto that train, you know?
Yeah.
They don't really stand for anything. Like, none of these politicians stand for anything.
Yeah.
They're just there to, you know, if they see there's a certain amount of popularity going in a certain direction, then they start going in that direction as well. That's why they're not leaders, you see. That's why they're not leaders. They're really followers.
Yeah.
You know, a real leader will go in his own direction regardless of what the popular opinion is. I mean, Donald Trump is a bit kind of like that. And then he brings people with them, you know.
Yeah,
that's why he's so popular. That's why people like Leo Varadkar, these people, nobody respects him because he's not a leader. He's just a middle manager,
Well, Brendan Howland thinks Labour can build progressive alliances between the Green Party, the Social Democrats and other progressives that want to have a change agenda to reflect the mood of the people now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway,
this whole green wave mood is a total fiction. It's a fabricated fiction.
Well, I hope I hope Labour do go in with that, because then that'll be the end of that fake Labour Party that we've seen for the last 20 years, or whatever. That's good, because it's creating a vacuum for a real working class movement. You know, so let them toddle off there. Just quickly, Fianna Fáil, I did get it right in my last video. I said they'll find it hard to get young people to vote for them, especially under 30s. And from RT exit poll, they said, for example, the standing of Brendan Smith, their candidate in Midlands North West, amongst those aged 18 to 24 is, drum roll, 0%. He got 0% from 18 to 24 to vote for him. His polling from 24 to 35 was 4%, and 35 to 44, 4%. So, I mean, Fianna Fáil, that was their Fianna Fáil candidate, Brendan Smith. And it wasn't much better for Fianna Fáil, Barry Andrews. I know he got in the end, but his support amongst 18 to 24s was 2%, you know? So Fianna Fáil do have a bit of a crisis. They're seen as the old fogey party. Like, it's like watching someone with bad dementia in the family slowly dying in front of you, over time. You know, that's the Fianna Fáil voter for you. But then, as I bring it back to when we were talking about immigration, not to worry, now you can bring in your voters.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
they won't know anything about Fianna Fáil. Just tell them it's a modern progressive party, the heartbeat of the country. We vote for us, please, and we'll give you lots of money.
That's right, and housing. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right.
And they won't know anything about Fianna Fáil. They won't know anything about Bertie Ahern bankrupting the nation. You know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So just say, oh, he's a lovely guy.
We have the divorce referendum. We wanted to comment briefly on that, maybe.
Do you want? I mean, divorce.
Just very, very briefly.
Okay, I'll let you go with that one.
So, in our initial discussion, we talked about the divorce referendum. And at the time, maybe I should have clarified this later, I said during that discussion that I was in favour of that referendum being passed, in other words, reducing the waiting time for divorce down to, was it 2 or 3 years? And after the discussion, I kind of regretted that position, because I started to rethink it, and because I began to realise that, you know, this was kind of similar to the abortion referendum, in that it was actually the Oireachtas, when I realised the Oireachtas would actually decide how long someone would have to wait for a divorce, you know, and in effect, in reality, can reduce it down to as short a period as they want, you know. I kind of, in the end, I voted against it, simply because I just don't trust them, you know. I thought it best, in my opinion, to play it safe. But look, in the end, it passed anyway, so.
Yeah.
I think it was like 80% of people voted in favour of that.
I don't think there was much debate on it. I mean, basically, you're going to see quickie divorces now, I guess.
Yeah, and the thing is as well, it's like we talked about the last time, how I was saying how they're just very slowly chipping away at the constitution. It's been, and we've all these little referendums being stuck in with other elections, and nobody's really aware of what's actually going on. You know, of course, they're giving us all the referendums we don't want, you know, and so that's another one. You know,
and also you can see, they'll probably see the cost benefit of every referendum. They'll see that's going to be great for solicitors and the courts and the judges. They're all going to make a pretty penny out of this, you know. So, and then the mayoral plebiscite, 2 out of 3, I suppose, not too bad.
But I was delighted that it was
I think you had a part to play in that, because I think people listened to our last video and said that makes sense, you know. It really was an eye-opener for me.
That's the only thing I could actually think of. But I saw, was it Dan Boyle, the green guy, who former pop star, who went off to, he's had to turn his back on pop stardom now, and has come back to politics and got elected. And I saw one of his tweets, I think it was him now, I hope I'm not wronging the man, but how he was talking about the fact that this motion was defeated, this plebiscite for a directly elected mayor. And he said, look, that has to be looked at very soon again, you know. And I was like, you know, fuck off. But so they do, it is something they want to bring in, there's no question about that. Rob, it'll be like the latest, you know, you didn't know what you were voting for, so we have to run the plebiscite again.
They've already said that. They've already said that we'll have to look at it. They've already said that we'll have to look at it again, and maybe we rushed it through, and rather than just like saying, okay, well, they don't want a mayor, so we'll just park it for 10 years. No, and they're I guarantee 2 years will be back again.
So that's telling me they desperately want that in for a particular reason. Yeah. And I'm just curious, was I correct? Or has it something to do with what I suggested, you know?
I think you should take some pride. Definitely our video.
Well, if there's anybody out there listening now, who, and if my comments in the last video were your reason for voting no, then let us know in the comments.
Yeah, that's good, Yeah, I guess 2 out of 3 is not bad.
But it'll, like, it'll be coming around again if Dan Boyle is in to do with it. So.
Yeah. Okay, so just have a quick look at our picks, what we said. Like, we were mostly going for Irexit. We were going for Gemma. We were going for Ben. We didn't really mention Aintu, but I was still hoping to do well, you know, the pro-life party, patter to beans. Mm-hmm. But it does overall seem abortion wasn't an issue, which is a bit disappointing, I have to be honest. It's like... it's like now that we've passed abortion, we don't want to even think about it, you know. And I just thought the pro-life candidates would do a little bit better.
Yeah, like it's like that old man I told you I spoke to. He said he was going to go for the Greens, and he, you know, we got onto the discussion of Fianna Fáil and all that as well. And I said to him, I asked him, was he pro-life? He said he was. Mm. And I said, but why are you voting like that? So he didn't really have an answer for me, you know. So I think a lot of people are just like that. They're pro-life, yes, but they don't seem to put the two and two together, you know.
So we lost. We lost the battle, so we'll just move on or something.
Yeah,
maybe.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we'll just go back to the way we always voted, you know. Yeah. So there was no kind of joined up thinking, if you like. Okay, yeah. I'm pro life, yes, but you know what? I still kind of have a. It's like an abused wife, you know. I'll go back to them again, you know. I'll go back to my husband again. It was same kind of analogy, if you like, you know. So they just haven't been abused enough yet, Rob. Yeah. Maybe when all these big carbon taxes come in, when your electricity bills goes from 150 a month to 500 euros every 2 months to 500 euros, they might start changing their minds then, you know. So they just need a bit more battering and abuse to cause them to think twice, maybe. I don't know.
Well, I know into he got 3 county councillors elected, and he was very close to getting Dublin, that actually getting 3 more, even more. But I thought they would do a bit better. But I mean, I guess the good news is they did knock an awful lot of Sinn Féin candidates out, so that's not so bad. And it'll be interesting to see how they move on from here. And I do wish them success, I guess. Yeah. You know?
And Renew got 1 seat as well, didn't they, in the county councils or in the councils?
Yeah, but that's they kind of needed it because they've had it before, you know, they've been around before. Mm. I think they needed to push on this election, but I don't know, to see where they're going to go. I was surprised that Matney didn't do well and didn't get elected in Galway, because I think he's a fantastic.
Yeah, I think in due course he will succeed, you know.
Yeah, I mean, as going back to Tobin, like, I mean, credit where it's due. It's hard to set up a party out of nothing, you know, in such a short space. It's not, is it even a year, you know? So
yeah, but there's obviously money behind him there, and there's no question about that. I just
So we'll just quickly look. Dublin, Herman Kelly, he got 2,500. Very surprised. I'm still struggling to make sense of that. Eamon Murphy got 2,900. I suppose that's okay for him. Ben Gilroy, he got 8,600. I know he was disappointed, but I think it's okay. Gemma got 10,622. I think that's not bad for what she stands for and how mad she is. So, you know, I think she can work on that.
Yeah. She'll do better next time, I think.
Midlands, Northwest, Patrick Green, Direct Democracy, 1,412, not so good. I think Direct Democracy, they've been in a few elections, and the guy in South, Jan Van de Ven, he got 1,400. I think Direct Democracy, I think those guys nearly want to hit on the head. They're not doing anything, really. Midlands, Northwest, James Miller got 1,490. He was on Gran Torino's show. He had a great interview. I don't know if you've seen it, but
I think I did,
he's just an ordinary guy, you know. Who cares about his country? And again, looking at him sitting down beside his fireplace, a good country man that was, you know, reared in the country, and he knows the Irish ways. And when you think of that black woman jumping up and down in Navan, and she hasn't a clue about Ireland. And this is, I'm just thinking of James Miller. Like, I thought he's a great candidate, and, you know, people don't care, do they? Yeah,
but he was independent, Rob, wasn't he?
Yeah, I know, but, like, it's just the two together. This is the old Ireland, and this is the new Ireland.
I know what you're saying, but she had the machine behind him. He didn't.
Yeah, but does it not make any difference to ordinary Irish people? What, do they not look at this and think...
Well, again, it comes down to most people probably didn't even know he existed.
Yeah, I know.
That's the difference between having the machine behind you
and being independent. Well, he said on Gran Torino, he just put his name down. He didn't do any canvassing or anything, you know. Yeah. Michael O'Dowd, Renua, he did okay. He got 7,677. Mm-hmm. Not too bad, I think. Fidelma Healy Eames, she did very well. She got 20,000. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah.
And maybe something she can build on.
Yeah, I think so.
Maybe
she
could become a TD or something, maybe out of that. Mm-hmm. So as you were saying, sorry, Peter O'Loughlin, yeah, he did much better than before. 4,181. Mm-hmm. So he'd be happy with that, because I think he was getting a few hundred the last time.
Just balancing, I know it's a different constituency, but if you just balance it up with what Herman Kelly got, you know, he got twice his votes, you know, so that was, you know, if you look at it that way.
Theresa Heaney, who I was very impressed with, I think she was on Gran Torino's show as well.
I gave her my number two.
Okay, she got 8,561. I think that's okay, you know, again, without a political machine behind you.
Mm-hmm.
My man, Dermot Patrick O'Flynn, he got 11,000. Yeah, which is okay. And I was going on, I thought he had a chance. But then I read after, when I said that in the video, I said he had a real chance. But then afterwards, no leaflets or no posters, no billboards, no advertising, no canvassing. And I was totally deflated after talking him up after that, you know?
Yeah.
Because you really have to do one of those things. Even a leaflet through a letterbox. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
I do, yeah.
Because... I can understand with posters or billboards, but leaflets.
Yeah, I mean, you could do that. You can have leaflets sent out with on post, so every house in your constituency can get a leaflet, you know?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, to be fair to Dermot, he did have a thing on his Facebook. He said, he kind of mentioned it, and he said he kind of said he was half-hearted, and he kind of apologised, really. He said, look, yeah. He said he wasn't really thinking about putting his name, and then he did in the end, and he kind of was saying, he was wondering, was it the right thing to do? And he knew heading into it a week out, he had no hope. And so, I mean, to be fair to him, you know, but I wish I'd known that before I put a bit of money on him, you know?
Yeah. Oh, you put a few quid in him, did you?
Yeah, I did actually, yeah. And tenner or whatever. You know,
Okay,
he got 11,000 from doing nothing, I suppose. Just Facebook, really. Which I guess it shows the power of Facebook if you got 11,000 from doing nothing, you know. Just think, if he had a few leaflets, he might have got an extra 5,000-6,000, you know.
Yeah, I suppose there's a whole generation of people who just don't look at TV anymore. They get their news from Facebook, from YouTube, Twitter, whatever, you know.
Well, but I do.
Yeah.
And I'm in my 40s, you know.
Yeah. Hmm.
So then we just quickly go to Dolores. I mean, I think she did excellent. She got 17,000. First time going for election. No party, nothing really in the media. I think that's fantastic. Mm-hmm. 17,000, that's what she finished up.
And by the time the general election will come around, the Irish Freedom Party, as they're now known, should be a fully registered party, you know? So maybe that would make a difference.
Yeah, so I mean... Yeah, I mean, obviously she impressed people going. She must have did a door-to-door canvas or something. She obviously has impressed people.
I'd say a lot of people have seen her lectures on YouTube as well, you know.
Yeah.
Some of them were excellent.
Yeah. Just a note, because we did talk about posters in the last video, and we were wondering what was the effect of them. There was a Galway County Councillor, Thomas Welby. He was one of the first people to be elected in the whole country, actually. He got in no problem. He nearly got double the vote he needed. He explains how he managed to top the poll without any posters. He used no posters. And he said on RT, it was going out and meeting people, shaking their hands, doorstepping. And that was it, you know?
Yeah.
And I really do agree. I think that's the way, because, you know, like people say, oh, no politician ever comes around this way. You know, and how often have you heard that? And, you know, someone comes around and shakes your hand and listens to you as you put on the kettle, have a cup of tea with them, you know? Mm-hmm. I think that sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but it's better than doing nothing.
Yeah, you have to meet people, really, don't you? I had a few people call to my door, but I missed them both. They left their business cards and whatever in the door. I wouldn't have voted for them anyway. They were just Fianna Gael and Fianna Fáilir, so.
Okay. So you didn't have a chance to shout at their
No, no, I didn't.
Time.
I wouldn't be the shouting person anyway, so. You know.
Yep. Okay. So where does that leave us now then, after all that? What do you think of the election overall?
I think it, you know, as I said already, I always felt that the MEP one as well, you know, where Gemma and the Our Exit Party were concerned, that it to me, in my mind, it was always a warm up for the general election, you know.
Okay.
And I think, like I said before, it'll give these people a lot of experience and maybe help them prepare a bit better for the general election, whenever that comes, probably next year sometime. So I thought it was a good kind of warm up, friendly match, if you like.
Okay.
You know, when Ireland are having their little soccer internationals, they have a little warm-up match beforehand. To me, that's what that was, really, you know. And because, you know, a lot of people don't know these people even exist yet, you know. No one knows Gemma O'Doherty. No, not many people know Dolores Cahill, you know. So it's my hope that these people just stay in the media spotlight now, be it on YouTube, on TV, if they can get on it or whatever. And then by the time the general election comes around, they'll be in a nice position to really... help people get to know them, know what they're about, you know, and hopefully achieve something then, you know.
Well, that's a good point. I mean, even with the RT thing, like, I mean, how could they, you could say, even with the, like, for example, Dolores Cahill, she got 17,000 now. So you could argue that she deserves to be on TV now because she did so well without a party backing her.
Yeah,
so
exactly. If you think about it, really, Rob, like, these people were essentially blacked out by the media.
Mm. And so she's done enough to show that there is an appetite for what she says. So she even with getting the numbers she got, she actually deserves her place in any future TV debate.
Absolutely, absolutely. You
know? I mean, she was very close to the Labour or People Before Profit or one of those. A thousand or something just off getting her.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? I'm just going to go on a little rant, Tim. So strap yourself in, okay?
Okay.
I'm actually a bit happy about the elections because it's kind of finally dawned on me that democracy in this style is a load of bullshit. And that's the whole idea for my video today. And thanks for letting me bounce off you too. I do see this as democracy in a banana republic. It's a sham democracy. And I have a few reasons for saying that because, you know, they laugh at us, the likes of us, and we're small fry on the internet. We're kind of, they say we're in an echo chamber and they say that we're not in the real world. But I do see it's the opposite. I think we're the ones living in our own reality. You know, I like to think that we're speaking the truth. And I like to think that all that that game that they've been playing, I think that's clown world, you know?
Mm.
We've seen the corruption, we've seen the nepotism, we've seen the shenanigans, and it's none of them believe anything they say. It's all fake. It's not real. And I think what we're doing, we're networking, we're making friends, we're expanding our thoughts, we're learning as we go. You know, and if I'm not learning, I'm standing still, you know? And it's a constant search for the truth, the reality. That's but up... above mentally and the way I live my life. And but they're stuck in the same old shit every 4 years. Nothing ever changes. Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael. Since the foundation of the state, it's been one or the other. Sometimes we get a bit of Labour, sometimes we get a bit of Green. Nothing ever changes. It's you know, it's the blandness that kills you.
Mm-hmm.
They're the ones that are living in a fake world, a fake reality. They're deluded. Would you not think so?
Yeah, I couldn't disagree with any of that. I really couldn't, you know.
Going on that, I think that what we're doing, I think we have to network, we have to look after each other. We can't always try and appeal to the general mass because we look at a lot of the general masses and they just keep voting for Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael. Mm-hmm. They're like, they're kind of morons, really. They're robots, they're NPCs, they're clowns.
Mm-hmm.
We shouldn't always try and appeal to them. We need them to come to us, not us bringing our words to them.
I think what we're doing really, Rob, is we're kind of building a community. A genuine community. You see, they're just reaching out to the people who are just busy living their own lives. They have nothing really in common with one another. Whereas what's happening with us online is that we're building a family or a community.
Yeah, exactly,
where,
yes.
Okay, we don't always agree with, like, I don't agree with Gemma O'Doherty on everything or whoever, you know, and vice versa. But at the same time, we're still kind of building a family where we agree on the essentials,
Yeah, and, I mean, it's more of a community than what they have, I think.
Oh, absolutely, you know, because we're kind of, and, you know, even the two of us chatting, we have people now who will watch this video, who listen to this video, they'll make comments, they'll say, well done, lads, that was an interesting discussion. And that's how a community, and I wouldn't expect people to agree on everything we say, you know, but that's not the point. The point is we're building kind of a little family where we can all get together, chat about things, share our thoughts or whatever.
Like-minded individuals.
Exactly. And that can grow, you know, it'll grow slowly, but, you know, over the course of time, if you think about us as a kind of a little log fire, and then Jem O'Doherty is another log on the fire, and Dolores Cahill is another log, and as, you know, when you put more and more logs together, the fire gets bigger and bigger, like a bonfire, you know, and you've all these little fires that are kind of starting to burn, or the embers are appearing throughout the country, and, you know, the hope would be that over the course of time these fires would start to meet up, you know, and that's how it's kind of going to grow in a very organic, natural way, you know, where people can, you know, throw out their ideas and learn new ideas, because, you know, that's important too, that you hear other people's ideas, that you listen to what people have to say. You know, if someone has a broadly similar worldview to yours, you can learn things, you know, like, for example, just one perfect example was, I was online recently, one guy was saying, you know, I'm giving Jem O'Doherty my number one vote, or it mightn't have been Jem, it could have been Herman Kelly actually, and that's it. And I was trying to explain to him that, look, no, it's important that you vote down the electoral form, because if you don't, your vote will be lost, it'll be transferred to, you know, it'll just be disposed of. That's why, you know, I was essentially explaining to him the importance of voting down the boxes, and he didn't actually even know that until I said it to him. So you know, so as we kind of build a community that way, we learn things from one another, and hopefully, you know, over the course of time, it will just grow and grow and grow to a point where it's a community that will no longer be able to ignore it. And hopefully it'll show itself, or we'll see the fruit of it through the electoral system, you know.
I agree with most of that. I'm not so sure about that. We have to worry about the electoral process, because it's in my opinion it's so bent and corrupted that I think we should just do our own thing. I mean, as I was saying, because, you know, like we need to stop caring about the general public, because basically the general public are clowns, you know. I hope I don't come across as arrogant, but, you know, I mean, honestly, Fine Gael, Fine Fall, every time. And I was just saying, like, we have to look after, as what we said, you have to look after your own kind, your own family, and your real friends and supporters online as well. And, you know, fuck the sheep and seek and support the lions, you know? Mm-hmm. Someone like Gran Torino, I really look up to him. I mean, I don't always agree with everything he puts out, but it gives you strength, you know? The people that he's meeting up and down the country. Anyway, we can't shed energy or time trying to wake people up. We can't just waste our energy. We just have to battle down and look after ourselves and our like-minded fellows, you know?
Well, that's kind of what I'm saying, really, Rob, is just focus on building our own community, and people will organically, naturally be drawn to it. You know, they'll come across an Irish Megaphone video by chance, or they'll come across, you know, a video by Gemma by chance or whatever. And that's how people get drawn in. They'll say, oh, this is interesting. Maybe I'll search out a few more of their videos. And that's how it happens. That's how I kind of got into a lot of this stuff over time. I just came across something by chance. It energized my interest in some fashion on one particular subject, and that's how you kind of, a community grows, and it happens organically over the course of time. And I think when you do get exposed to a lot of this stuff, it's very hard to go back to the old way of thinking, you know.
Exactly. I mean, you use the word energy, it's a good word to use, because it kind of gives you, empowers you, gives you strength, you know, because you're on the right path. I mean, like, how many times have I seen Irish people make mistakes, you know, Bertie Ahern, Brian Cowan, you know, Enda Kenny, Jesus, you know. You're banging your head against the wall, all these no politicians again and again. And it's like, you know, it's all you can do is speak your truth online. I mean, I don't beg for favors or help, and I don't owe anyone anything, just my family for patience and putting up with me, you know. So it's not like these, I mean, you see all these politicians, you know, they're bent over backwards. They owe somebody something. I mean, Vardaker, how does he get to a position like that? Not through sheer charisma and skill, You know, he must owe somebody something down the line.
Mm.
Or it was Simon Coveney, pro-life, and now he's pro-death. Or Simon Harris the same. He used to be very pro-life. So how do you change on a sixpence, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Or how do you change so easy? You must owe, but like, I owe nothing to anybody, only my family.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yep.
So I just want to say something about elections. So elections and democracy, as in Ireland, it's a sham. It's a game. By playing by their rules, you're always going to lose. They don't give you the time to express your opinion. They don't give you the time to express your opinions. They don't give, you know, the likes of Dolores Cahill, the likes of Gemma, the likes of Ben Gilroy, all of the independents. They don't give them time to express their opinions. They kind of ridicule them. They slander them even. While the main parties have a zombie volunteers all over the country helping them, built up over many years. They're tax funded to the hilt and the big money behind them. I know Fine Gael spent an awful lot of money pushing Maria Walsh. It wasn't like £300 that Ben Gilroy spent on his viral video, for sure. They saturate the playing field, as we said, with nondescript candidates and opportunistic parasites. They try their best to disenfranchise half the electorate by making the political process so boring and bent that most people know it's a waste of time and don't want any part of it. So, you know, I'm beginning to think that the best thing you do now is not vote at all. I'm kind of totally, I see it as a complete sham. And people say your civic duty, but I don't think so in a rigged game. So I say no thanks. Now, that doesn't mean that the alternative party should not go for election, because they can use the elections to spread their message. I'm sure, like, Gemma Doherty has got more subscribers now because of what she did. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that, you know, Dolores Cahill has put her name out there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I've certainly never heard of her before the election. Now, mm-hmm. even if they don't get elected, they're gaining their own support base, you know. They're spreading the message. So for that, it's useful.
Mm-hmm. But the only way to power, Rob, is to get elected, you know, so...
But is it real power? Because, you know, you're voting for a civil service. They don't have power. I mean, it's not real power. I mean, none of them can do fuck all. I mean, without going straight up to their higher offers, they can't make decisions. And it goes the whole way to Brussels and probably even higher up, you know.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't be too down on it. I think it's a game and, you know, what we're doing or what Gran Torino's doing... It's more realistic. I mean, we can go out on the street and we can meet up and we can do things. To me, that's real democracy. I see it as democratic. I'm voicing my opinion. No one's telling me not to. I'm making friends online. I'm sharing my ideas. I'm learning, you know. So what? It's not like, you know, it's not like an old woman being wheeled out of a nursing home to vote for Fianna Fáil, you know. That's not democracy. And I've seen that happening, you know. Because I worked on elections in the past, and you should see the tricks the Fianna Fáilers get up to.
Really?
They bust them in, you know?
Really?
Yeah. He used to have a big bus, and he used to go around all the old folks' home and bring them in on the bus. You know?
Yeah.
Fianna Fáilers. I don't know that they do it now, but I wouldn't be surprised. Would you be surprised if they didn't?
But will they get away with that now?
Well, technically, they're helping people to vote. They're not telling... I mean, I'm sure they could argue that we're not telling them how to vote. We're just helping them to vote.
Yeah.
They'd probably say it's like, oh, the poor old people, they can't vote.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's all irrelevant. When Brexit happens, Italy follows, the Deutsche Bank collapses, then we'll see what Mairead McGuinness will do for us.
Yeah.
They'll do nothing. And I also think that Ireland, 50%, you know, remember, there's 50% people there without a voice. You know, I think Ireland's ripe for someone like Salvini to come along, I think.
Mm-hmm.
We're just waiting for that person.
Yeah.
It's you, Tim.
Yeah? Maybe it is. Right.
You're from Cork, anyway. Cork, yeah. They always come from Cork. Okay, so that's it, Tim. I think we can edit that to something good.
Yeah. I'll just...